All right. Okay, good evening, everyone. Would you please rise and join us for the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Please call the roll.
Councilwoman Nicholson?
Here.
Councilwoman Marcott?
Here.
Councilman Dooley?
Here.
Councilman Marcocchia?
Here.
Supervisor Colavita?
Here. Good evening, everyone. First matter on the agenda is a public hearing, which, Mr. Rady, you want to speak on that?
Yes, thank you. Yes, thank you, Supervisor. At this time, I'd recommend to the board that we table this matter. Due to the fact that the last meeting was just 2 weeks ago, under the law, we had to have certain requirements to notice certain municipalities, the state, the county, and because of the time frame, it wasn't possible to get it under the legal guidelines that had to be properly noticed. So I recommend that we table it to the February 15th meeting.
Okay, do we have to republish again?
Yes. Well, I already put out a notice to go out for the 15th of February, yes.
Okay, thank you. All right, first opportunity to address the board on agenda items
so
only.
We should set the hearing, public hearing for the 15th?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, there being no one seeking to do that, we'll go to approval of minutes of the January 4th, January 17th, and January 18th town board meetings. Any modifications or amendments?
No, but I'm also submitting the annual report and the correspondence if you just want to receive that at this time.
Sure, too. Would you like to comment on that at all?
No, if there's any questions, I think it's self-explanatory.
We can jump to that. That was pretty impressive. You guys took in more than 300-something thousand, right?
Yep.
$20 at a time, which is difficult because I know it's a lot of work going on there. I was also interested to see all of the different requests, 528 handicap permits, 2,000-plus Garth Road parking permits, 116 FOIL requests, 146 marriage licenses, which is a nice thing. And something that Linda and I and the two judges get to do is marry people. So it's kind of nice to do that. It's a nice thing we get to do.
And I'll just add that on February 22nd, 2022, is 2-2-2-2-2.
That's right.
And so I already have two marriages scheduled for that day.
2 o'clock?
One at 2:22 and the other one in the morning. So
that's good.
Oh, that's great.
It's fun.
Well, my daughter lived, not to go on here, but she was born on the 12th day of December, 12-12. So at 12 in the year 00. So I called her 12 seconds after 12 o'clock on the 12th of December in 2012. So I said, Livy, you got all the 12s lined up here.
All the 12s.
So unfortunately, neither of us won any money in lotto or anything like that, but it was still nice. Anyway, so with that being said, we'll accept those minutes, annual minutes as well. Any further modifications or amendments? There being none, please call the roll.
I just need a motion and
I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
I'll make the motion.
I'll second same. Please call the roll.
Councilwoman Nicholson? Councilwoman Marcott?
Aye.
Councilman Dooley?
Aye.
Councilman Marcocchia?
Aye.
Supervisor Colavita?
Aye. Okay, reports of departments, boards, and commissions. Law Department?
Yes, good evening. First, I have a resolution authorizing the settlement of a certiorari proceeding instituted by the Reformed Church, affecting the premises known as Section 6G, Block 1, Lot 24, property 180 Pondfield Road. The assessment years in this property are 2019 through 2021, and the tax years 2020 through 2022, and the total town tax refund on this property is zero. The reason being that because this is a church, under the law, it's exempt from paying any town, fire, and county taxes.
It's our kind of tax cert. I'll move that. Ask for a second, please.
Second.
Call the roll.
Councilwoman Nicholson?
Aye.
Councilwoman Marcott?
Aye.
Councilman Dooley?
Aye.
Councilman Marcocchia?
Aye.
Supervisor Colavita?
Aye.
Okay, next I have a resolution authorizing a settlement of a certiorari proceeding instituted by Dolce National Real Estate, LLC, affecting the premises known as Section 60, Block 4, Lot 18, property 835 White Plains Road. Assessment years on this property are 2015 through 2020, and the tax years 2016 through 2021, and the total town tax refund on this property is $8,502.50.
So moved.
Second.
Please call the roll.
Councilwoman Nicholson?
Aye.
Councilwoman Marcott?
Aye.
Councilman Dooley?
Aye.
Councilman Marcocchia?
Aye.
Supervisor Colavita?
Aye.
Okay, and last I have a resolution authorizing a settlement of a certiorari proceeding instituted by Dolce National Real Estate, LLC, affecting the premises known as Section 60, Block 4, Lot 20, the address 831 White Plains Road. Assessment years on this property are 2015 through 2020, tax years 2016 through 2021, and the total town tax refund on this property is $4,388.16.
So moved.
Second. Please call the roll.
Councilwoman Nicholson?
Aye.
Councilwoman Marcotte?
Aye.
Councilman Dooley?
Aye.
Councilman Marcoccia?
Aye.
Supervisor Colavita?
Aye. Okay, we can receive and review the December 2021 clerk's report. Anything further to add? Okay, that moves us to correspondence. Remember from the memorandum from the chief of police regarding the grant acceptance for DARE. This is a grant in the amount of $5,000 from the community board of directors, community fund board of directors, and we're very delighted that they're choosing to do that. They have been on board with DARE since the very beginning, as was the Rotary Club many, many years ago when I was the president of the Rotary Club. So we thank them for their contribution, and I'll make the motion to accept this $5,000 sum from SAME. Anyone second SAME?
Second.
Thank you. Please call the roll.
Councilwoman Nicholson?
Aye.
Councilwoman Marcotte?
Aye.
Councilman Dooley?
Aye.
Councilman Marcoccia?
Aye.
Supervisor Colavita?
Aye. B, we handled. C is a memo from the assessor on a tax map maintenance contract, and years ago we decided that it was better, more inexpensive, and more efficient to outsource our tax map maintenance, and we've been doing that for quite a while now. So Todd Hutton, our assessor, is asking that we renew the contract for tax map maintenance for the year 2022 at a cost of $13,900. And MRB Group has been servicing the town for quite a while, and the funds have been provided for in the 2022 budget. And this is very necessary because every time a piece of property is subdivided, redivided, consolidated, all the maps all change and everything has to be adjusted. And for a while there, we hadn't done it for years and years back, you know, at the turn of the century there. Anyway, so that being said, I'll make the motion to approve SAME and ask for a second.
Second.
Thank you. Please call the roll.
Councilwoman Nicholson?
Aye.
Councilwoman Marcotte?
Aye.
Councilman Dooley?
Aye.
Councilman Marcoccia?
Aye.
Supervisor Colavita?
Aye. There being no miscellaneous business, we have council member reports. Councilman Marcoccia?
Thank you, Supervisor. I have a brief report, and I just want to take the opportunity to thank EVAC and our Eastchester Police. On Sunday afternoon, while out with my family, I slipped and fell on a patch of ice. It was a very hard fall. As soon as I hit the ground, I knew I was hurt. 911 was called, and our Eastchester Police Department arrived quickly to assist, as did EVAC. EVAC treated me, splinted my fractured wrist, and transported me to the hospital. I'm thankful to both our police department and EVAC for their quick response, experience, and professionalism. Although I will be requiring further medical treatment in the days to come, they were just amazing in stabilizing me very quickly. You just never know when you need some help. I can say firsthand, we have the best of the best in our town. And I just want to thank them tonight for all that they do for us. Thank you.
Thank you.
And that concludes my report.
Hope you feel better. Councilman Dooley?
Thank you, Mr. Supervisor. I'd just like to thank the Highway Department for a great job with the latest snowstorm. A lot of snow, a lot of wind, some ice. So great job in cleaning the streets. Also want to put out a reminder that on Sunday, March 13, 2022, will be the Eastchester, the 16th annual Eastchester Irish American Social Club St. Patrick's Day Parade. So there's going to be better weather for that. There always is, or most of the time there is. Congratulations again to Tim McGrath for being the Grand Marshal for the third year without a parade. So, and Kathy Deegan for the honoree. Thank you, Mr. Supervisor.
Okay. Councilwoman Nicholson.
Thank you, Mr. Supervisor. Good evening, everyone. I just have two announcements happening in our community. Come out this Saturday for a blood drive to support the Relay for Life team rally for Regina. It's at the Tuckahoe Community Center from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. on Saturday. Walk-ins are welcomed. So as most of you, I'm sure, know, there's been a critical need for blood, so this would be a good deed to do. And on behalf of the Interact, Rotary Interact Club, they're having a pet drive for the New Rochelle Humane Society next Saturday, February 12th, between the hours of 2 and 5 p.m. at the Eastchester Library. If you go to the Humane Society website, you would see their products that they have that they're looking to collect. It's from cleaning supplies to toys and food items, even old blankets and sheets and towels they're collecting. So the Rotary Interact will be out there in front of the library between 2 and 5 p.m. on February 12th. That is all I have. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilwoman Marcotte?
Thank you, Supervisor. Just some information for our Bronxville people. If you subscribe to the One Square Mile newsletter, it came out today, the February edition. If you don't subscribe to it, you can always sign up on their website. And just some tidbits of information from that. Beginning this spring, Bronxville residents will have the choice of paying their taxes in person, or they're going to be able to pay them on a portal. So that is something that is being implemented now, and I think there'll be more conversation on how to use the portal and things of that nature. But those are good things for the residents of Bronxville. Additionally, in the newsletter, there's a comprehensive breakdown of where your taxes go, which was very informative. Lastly, the Village Board is having conversations in terms of considering a tree ordinance. Bronxville happens to be one of the very few municipalities that currently don't have a tree ordinance in place, so that's a good thing. So good things happening in Bronxville right now. And lastly, very good news, the Bronxville Movie Theater is going to reopen hopefully in March, and that theater had been operating nonstop since 1929, and due to COVID, it was forced to close. So I know a lot of residents are excited about that news. And then I just wanted to give a shout out to all of the DPWs and our emergency workers for handling the snowstorm. It was messy, it was a lot of snow. And lastly, always pitching for the snow angels, we had dozens of them across the town helping many, many seniors and those who maybe were just temporarily unable to handle the snow, and we're always looking for more. And in particular, looking for them on Alcamont, Anderson, and Marbledale Road. So if you know anybody, or if you yourself want to volunteer, you can always reach out to myself or any of the town board members of the supervisor's office. And that concludes my report, Supervisor.
Yeah, that's a great program. It really is a great program.
Okay. I should also, I'm sorry, Teresa Nicholson helps me tremendously with that, and Gina Lee out of Tuckahoe. So the three of us together coordinate it, and it is a lot of work, and we appreciate that.
Yeah, it's nice. Well, it's nice having the kids out there doing the right thing. It's nice for a change,
Yes.
Anyway, my own report, just a couple of things to mention. First, we had a meeting with this engineer group that is conducting a feasibility study for the indoor pool over at Lake Isle Country Club. And it was a very productive meeting. We're there for a couple of hours, and we kind of downloaded what our thoughts were, what we thought would be an appropriate place and system for the indoor pool to be constructed. Or something else to be converted. It was a very good time well spent. We're probably going to end up engaging a contractor or an engineer to examine the site itself to do some feasibility with regard to any rocks below grade. What is the surface like? We had the issue with the community center. We want to make sure that doesn't happen again with fill, and we want virgin soil down there. So we're going to do that. We're going to check that all out. But it was good to go, and this thing is definitely moving forward, and we're delighted that hopefully we'll have a plan together and go out to bid at some point this fall. But it was very productive time, and we're going to do some significant analysis of it. Also, just want to remind everybody that, it's tough now with everyone plowing and, everything going on. So if you get a chance, try to avoid pushing all your snow into the street. I know people get upset when the snow gets pushed in your driveway after you finish shoveling it. But the highway guys do a great job. But, people don't move their cars. And then people claim that the street isn't plowed. But that's because there are a bunch of cars that were left overnight. So you got to get the cars off the streets. We can clean the streets. And everything will be pristine by the time you get up in the morning. But, please be cognizant of that and try to make every effort you can to get the cars off the road so our guys can go in, clean everything up, and then we can go back to the way things should be. That concludes my report, and that brings us to the second opportunity to address the board. Frank, come on. Good evening.
Good evening. Frank Sweeney. Just want to let you know that I'm pursuing, or at least trying to get some resolution on some items that I did send to the supervisor this afternoon. So the questions that I'm going to raise are nothing new, but I'd like to at least try to see if we can't move forward. It's been approximately 3.5 months since we last spoke in terms of the installation of the cabling, dangling cables, drooping cables. The connector boxes are hanging from the lines. I provided a number of photos, directions, locations, pole identifiers to the DWP. I've seen little or no activity.
That's not the case. The Mr. Letella sent the list of lines that were down or, in your opinion, dangling or whatever the case might be, or dangerous, to not just Verizon, but also to Altice and to Con Ed. Okay. Also, there have been several crews not doing a sufficient amount of removals, but there have been crews in town from Verizon. Turns out that the majority of the problem is on Altice. It's the Altice customers that that these lines have predominantly come from, not so much Verizon. Con Ed also has a couple of lines that they have to deal with. They are not powered lines. They are, you know, just some kind of, you know, whatever phone line Con Ed had out there. So there has been activity, but you have to understand, of course, that for us, it's important, and we've communicated that to Verizon and to Altice. However, for them, it's a very, very low priority, and they're giving us a little lip service, they're doing a little bit of work, but not enough that, you know, it would satisfy you or us. But, you know, we can't go out there and cut wires down. They're not ours, it's not our property, and I don't want anyone hurt either, especially if something's connected to a powered line. You know, we have to make sure our guys are okay. But we're doing the best we can with regard to compelling them to help us out.
I just perceive is that we've identified specifically poles, places, identifiers. I mean, there's no mystery here in terms of where they are.
I know. We know that.
But the idea is that you can't send... I'll give you a very specific example. There's 200-foot of cable laying at the foot of Lakeview Avenue. That's been there for at least 9 months. This is not the first time I've spoke about it specifically to you in terms of the capability. Do we have a problem with the senior management to get involved in getting these things done?
Yeah, I mean, Frank, let's be clear. I can't go, or not me personally, but the town can't go and cut that stuff out because we don't own it. It's like if Verizon came in or Altice, instead of ripping up our curbstone and doing whatever, they don't own it, so they can't touch it. I don't disagree with you. It's an issue. But we are pushing them as best we can. They're just not responding like we respond. You know, we respond, some problem comes up, we're on top of it.
No question
about it.
But these
guys, they could care less. They're like giving us a little bit of lip service. They send a crew here, there, a couple of crews here and there. But, you know, we can't compel them to do this. We're going to try and have that in our agreements. We're presently negotiating both Altice and Verizon for their cable renewal contracts.
When is that due?
Oh, that's happening now, presently. The committees, what one is up and the other just, one is already up and one just ended a couple of weeks ago. So we're in the middle of negotiation right now with them. And though, you know, usually this is not germane to a cable contract. It's more about stations and installations and rates and all, but we're going to try and work that in. And if that does not work, if it turns out that that's something that they refuse to negotiate upon, then we have to look at what our options are, which may well be some form of local law which prohibits, you know, the removal, or does not prohibit removal, which would facilitate or require the removal of wires that have been downed or remain for a certain period of time, or would have to cage that in some language that would be appropriate and pass a constitutional test. But that would be the last resort if we can't do anything with them in our contract.
It just appears that besides all the other stuff, I'm not asking the town to go out and cut the cables or look at the cables.
Frank, if we could, we would.
I realize
that. Have guys out there lopping the stuff off in a heartbeat.
I realize it. But it just seems like it's notoriously getting worse that someone's cutting the cables 6 or 8 feet from the cable line and leaving them hanging, just dangling right there in the middle of nowhere. And that brings me to the point that if someone changes their cable service, who is responsible for leaving the end line for the new service provider? Do we have anything in writing that provides us with some recourse?
No, I just know that the cable that's installed in your home, including that which is in your home, is property of the cable company. Yeah. So the exiting company would be the owner of those bundled wires.
Now we have I change my service. They come in and put a new line in. What happens to the old line that's just hanging from the pole?
Right, that's the point. We're saying that the company that's exiting, the company that you got rid of, is responsible for collecting that wire and sufficiently securing it, safely securing it to the pole, removing it, whatever the state of the art is at that time. That's what we want them to do.
Well, clearly, you know,
there's another issue too. Yeah. The other problem we had was with Con Ed. They, a lot of times, if during a storm a pole was damaged, right, they would come in and put a sister pole in, but they would leave the old pole there forever. They would literally they would harness it to the new pole, and then when they got around to it, they would come back and take the old pole out. Like there's one pole on White Plains Road, right by Tutabella, by the little gas station there and in Sam's Mart, that, you know, not a lot of it, but there's a little piece of it is right above the curb. So if there's a car or a van that has a rear view mirror, side view mirror, I should say, that's getting a little close to the curb there, it could be an accident. So, you know, we've been on top of them. We spoke to Con Ed, to Luigi Vigna, who was our contact there, to get that taken care of immediately because it's a definite hazard. So, you know, we're working with all groups of the utilities.
I mean, do the cable companies provide the town with some sort of reports of ad moves and changes during the month or during the quarter?
No, not really. We get a franchise report from them that we usually get quarterly or depends how long, sometimes biannually. And that just gives us number of households and rates and whatnot because we have a franchise fee we get from them.
I
so they give us a report, but it doesn't give turnover. It doesn't. We could just go from quarter to quarter. You know, let's say they had 5,000 households quarter one, quarter two it is 4,900. You know, that's the most we get.
But the idea is at least has an impression that we know where the things are going. Mm-hmm. People are changing, and we need at least have an idea of what's really going on.
Well, a lot of people are just cutting the cable. You know, they use the cable for the internet service, and they don't have the cable line for their televisions.
But clearly, the ones that are hanging from the cable itself, about 6 or 8 feet down, they're being done by somebody else. They're done by someone who has a truck that has the capability of cutting that wire 6 or 8 feet from the feeder wire and leaving it hanging there. Now, I know they'll swear by they're not supposed to touch each other's cables. That's a given. But clearly, anywhere in town, I can show you a dozen places that those wires are being cut. And they're not town people cutting them. I don't believe the residents are cutting them. These people, it's 10 or 12 feet off the ground. And nothing's being done. The other thing is that when they provide these disconnects, the homeowner should be aware that there may be some additional monies involved if the other previous contractor has to come out and disconnect the wire. We have no recourse right now. I'll give you an example. There happens to be a multifamily house on Brook Street. There must be 15 cables from the pole, just dangling, free as you can see. I mean, there's only four apartments in the whole place. So what they're doing is they're doing what's least effective for them and don't really give a hoot about what it does to the quality of town. I just think we need to put a little more pressure, and if it requires that the contract be rewritten or possibly delayed in some fashion until they step up to the bar and do what I think is right. I don't think anybody here identifies that it's not the right thing to do.
Yeah, absolutely.
So now it's a matter of just getting it done. But it may require maybe some legal help, if that's the requirement. but they don't clearly mention in terms of a direct responsibility. We've asked them to do it. They've said taking their time about doing it. This one at the corner of Lakeview Avenue, I'm not sure what they're waiting for. Maybe the Messiah.
Oh, hopefully not.
Well,
hopefully not. But yeah. Frank, you're not going to get an argument from us.
No,
we recognize that. We just hope you recognize that this is, you know, we have limited control over the circumstance. And luckily, you know, normally our terms for the cable contracts, you know, some used to be 10 years, now they're 20 years. So it couldn't be better timing as far as this is concerned for you. So, and for us for that matter. So hopefully we can flex a little muscle and get it straightened out.
Well, it can't be soon enough for me. I don't think it can be soon enough for most of the people in town. I've come to realize is that people do realize that their wires are hanging.
Sure.
They do realize that the craftsmanship of swinging these wires around right in front of Lake Isle, the drooping is 6 foot from the cable lane. That is non-professional work. Somewhere we're accepting it as professional. We're accepting it as the thing to do. I say no. I don't know who's supervising them, who has the responsibility to supervise them, but clearly we've kind of missed the boat. That's my opinion. I appreciate if you could tighten it up a little bit,
sure.
Get some work done, and I'd like to come back and say, hey, we had a great avenue.
We had success.
And hopefully we can get it done.
Great.
Okay? Thank you.
Thank you, Frank. Thank you very much. No one else? Okay. Anything further from me, anyway? No? Okay. Motion to adjourn?
So moved.
All in favor?
Second.
Aye.
Thank you.
Aye.